Thanks, everybody. So as you said, I'm Matt Johansen. This is Johnathan Kuskos. We're with WhiteHat Security. We do this top 10 thing every year, so we're kind of here to share the results of it. So just a little bit about me. This was an old bio picture of mine, so Johnathan saw it fit to use his elaborate Photoshop skills to add my beard length so that it was a little bit more realistic. I've done this speaking thing once or twice. I have a background in pen testing. I'm a hacker turned dark side of management, but as I like to say, at least it's not sales. I'm hiring a lot. If you want to get into web AppSec entry level in Santa Clara, Houston, and soon to be Belfast, feel free to come talk to us afterwards and shoot over your resumes.
And I'm Johnathan Kuskos. I'm one of the application security engineers for WhiteHat Security. I'm also one of the Houston OWASP chapter leaders for at least the next month or so. Like you said, I'm moving to Belfast, so then I'll be helping start up the OWASP chapter in Belfast. So if you want to speak down in Texas or overseas in the EU, I'm the guy you want to talk to. Hit me up sometime while you're here.
So a little bit of history about the top 10. So how many of you guys are familiar with the top 10 and us doing it over the past couple of years? Cool. Good number of you. Very nice. Awesome. That's great to see. So for those of you who don't know, the top 10, this is a very community-driven effort that we put forth that we collect all of the crazy amount. There's just tons and tons and tons of new research every year. And it's kind of impossible to stay on top of it unless you're like professional Twitter user or something like that, right? And so we try to aggregate all these things, and we get somewhere between 50 and 80 new web hacking techniques submitted every year that gets whittled down to a top 15 by community vote in no particular order. And then we have a panel of expert judges that very graciously submit their time, take a little bit more time, and order the top 10, whittle it down to 10 and order it. This is really just about paying homage to the web security researchers for the crazy amount of work that gets done every year. So this is just a little bit of the history of who has won, the total number of new techniques that we get in any given year and the winners of that year. So as you can see, encryption has been extremely popular, crime beast, Oracle padding attacks, all this stuff. For the past couple of years, encryption has been king. It's not the case this year. So without further ado, this is this year's top 10 web hacks. So there's no way that we're going to be able to cover all of these in 45 minutes. So just please bear with us. We're going to be the Busta Rhymes of AppSec. We're going to talk through this really, really fast. We're going to blow through 10 through 6, just kind of give like a shout out to those guys and the research that they did and give you a really high level. And then we're going to try to deep dive into the top 5 since they made it to the top 5. So, number 10.
Cool. So starting with number 10 is the HTML5 hard disk filler. Now with HTML5 comes the ability to use local storage. With that, you would expect that there should be an upper bound on the amount of data that you can save. Can you guys hear me now? The mic? Cool. So there should be an upper bound on local storage for how much data that you can save. Now, with the specification, just states that there should be some upper bounds. Now, what actually happens in practice is that Chrome has a 2.5 megabyte cap, Firefox and Opera have a 5 megabyte cap, Internet Explorer has a 10 megabyte cap. So this also should apply to subdomains of any given host. Chrome, Safari, and IE all ignore this. Firefox is a little bit better. It will institute a 10 megabyte cap across all shared sources, but the other browsers don't. So what that means is that you can fictitiously fill data up in fictitious subdomains over and over, just iterating through until you essentially fill up the hard drive with junk data. And that's what Firas here did. He created filldisk.com, opened it up in a VM, give it enough time, it's just going to crash. It's going to fill with junk data.
Don't go to that bottom URL on your computer that
you
care
about. Do it in the VM if you want to check it out, but it's pretty cool.
That is the true meaning of proof of concept right there, that bottom one. So it will fill up your hard drive. So number 9 is by a gentleman that's sitting right here. You can give a wave. This is Robert R. Snake Hansen. He figured out some cool ways to decloak Tor hidden services. I'm not going to do it remotely any justice, so you can go to that blog link down there. But there was a few different methods that he theorized that could be possible into finding Tor hidden service, actual locations, actual IP addresses of Tor hidden service web servers.
So number 8 is an empirical study done by Sebastian Leakes, Ben Stoke, and Martin Johns for finding DOM-XSS automated across the Alexa top 5,000 sites. So what they did was they created a tool that crawled about 480 different domains, finding 6,000 unique cross-site or DOM cross-site scripting vectors, and based off of that result, they're stating that about 9.6% of the Alexa top 5,000 contain at least one serious DOM XSS flaw. That number is probably much higher, but this is all done through automated means, no human testing.
Number seven are these two schlubs. They kind of came up with some stuff. That's the unphotoshopped picture of my profile picture. But yeah, so Jeremiah and I created a browser botnet via an ad network. We actually just paid an ad network to host our JavaScript code and actually did this and measured the size of a botnet that we could create per dollar. And it's actually incredibly cheap and incredibly fast. And we denial of service ourselves. And then as a follow-up research, we actually got permission from Akamai to do some serious testing on a web server that they protected, which actually was akamai.com. And they let us try to denial service that. And we created a serious amount of noise for about $50. It was really, really super cheap and kind of a cool cool technique. This has been recorded a few times, so some links to the slides and the recording of the actual talk.
So number six is XML out-of-band data retrieval. Now what this is an expansion on the XML external entity attack in which you create an entity tag that is both part file contents and part URL resource. So this was demonstrated by Timur, Yunusov, and Alexey, Osipov at Black Hat EU last year. What this basically allows you to do is to now use XXC to fetch files that are non-well-formed. Typically, if the file that you're reading isn't well-formed, when the XML parser validates it, it's going to crash. So this way, the file is returned before the XML parser crashes, and you can basically read non-well-formed data, with the exception of binary.
How many of you guys do like web app pen testing for a living? A good handful of you. Have you guys had fun with XXE this year? It's just everywhere, right? So yeah, this was a kind of unique way to attack that. All right, so number five, we're going to kind of deep dive into some of these. So the first couple are going to be a hat tip to encryption again, you know, the winners from the past couple of years. So three of the top five are encryption, but they didn't win this year. So these gentlemen researchers out of the University of London found some theoretical weaknesses in RC4, which is at the time and probably still is the most popular algorithm used in TLS. So I think this slide is probably a little bit redundant for this conference. This is more for when we're giving it to a less of an AppSec crowd, but since that's the name of the conference, I hope a lot of you know how SSL and TLS works. But the one important thing that I do want to point out on this slide of how SSL and TLS works is that it's not just HTTPS. Everyone thinks SSL TLS, they think HTTPS, right? The TLS is used to encrypt a lot of other protocols, so this weakness does not just mean, oh, websites, right? This means that you can decrypt encrypted traffic using other protocols. But basically, yeah, TLS using some algorithm and a bunch of the ciphers, a number of algorithms and a number of cipher suites that are options for TLS is used to encrypt most of the web traffic that we see today. So what is RC4? This is the most text on any slide I've ever written. I hate beefy slides like this, but like I said, we're trying to do a whole Black Hat talk in about 5 minutes here, right? So RC4 is one of the algorithms that's used in TLS. The important takeaway here, you guys can take pictures of this if you don't know about RC4 and you want to read about it, but the important part is that the way that it works is that it's going to take some sort of short key and stretch it out by padding it with pseudo random bytes. The weakness that is going to be attacked, as you're going to see in the next couple slides, is that pseudo random is not so pseudo random when you're looking at really, really large data sets of this stuff. As you can see, the randomness, quote unquote. So this is some stats. I think this is from, this is in SSL Labs, but this is some stats of at the time of this research, about 50% of TLS connections that were monitored by ICSI were using the some combination of RC4 cipher suites. So this theoretical weakness could be very prevalent at the time. The reason this was so big, actually, was kind of funny, was that if you remember last year's winner of the top 10 web hacks that I had up on the slide earlier was actually Beast. And Beast was attacking the CBC, which is kind of one of the other major options. If you're not going to use RC4, you can use CBC. And so one of the remediation efforts for Beast was, hey, switch over to RC4. Well, okay, so now we have weaknesses in RC4. So what's next, right? Last three top 10s, I guess, CBC has been attacked. So now RC4 is being attacked. So there's two different attacks being discussed by these researchers here. The first one's a multi-session attack. And what that means is that you're going to need a lot of different TLS handshakes. It's not just one connection one encrypted TLS connection, it's a lot of them. You're going to need a new handshake every single time, right? So, I mean, and when I say a lot, who wants to do 2 to the 30th for me real quick? Scream it. It's a billion. Okay, so it's a billion TLS handshakes that you're going to need in order to reliably recover the first 220 of the first 256 bits of encrypted traffic. So this is very theoretical at the moment, right? But what do we know about theoretical attacks, right? They're just going to get faster and faster. So if you don't want to try to get that whole first 256 bytes, you can knock that down to 2 to the 24, which I think is 16 million. It's not in our notes anymore. I think it's about 16 million, which is a much smaller number. And you can get certain bytes reliably, not that whole big chunk. So what's a real world scenario of this, right? So this is really theoretical, but what could, if you could imagine a billion TLS handshakes happening without someone noticing, what could be reliably recovered in the first 256 bits of some connection stream, right? Is cookies, right? So we can go after session cookies. So the other reason that we want to go after session cookies is that, say it's something like Gmail, right? It's a known cookie, it's a known entity, it's a known character set. You can actually use that information. It's not that you don't know anything about the plain text. You know a significant amount about the plain text of a known cookie, right? So if you know that, you can actually use that, and the math starts to become a slightly more realistic than a billion requests. Still quite theoretical, but this is something that if you were to be man-in-the-middling someone, this is the kind of exact same traffic that's going to be sent over and over again over new handshakes, right? Something like a session cookie is the same piece of plain text sent over and over and over again, right? So if I was able to force your browser, what happened? And we're back. If I was able to force your browser to just send a lot of requests with JavaScript or something like that, you know, a cookie is a realistic thing that we could go after, right? I kind of covered all this, right? Math goes from your enemy to your friend if you know something about the plain text that you're trying to capture. So again, tons of text on a slide. So second attack. This one is a little bit more interesting because you don't need a new TLS handshake every time. Okay, so this is a single connection, single session attack. You still need quite a bit of requests to actually be played through, but you only need one handshake, so it's actually a little bit more reliable and a little bit faster for whatever reason, because math, right? Who knows? But this stuff is feasible. This has been proven feasible, but not practical, right? You need some ridiculous amount of sessions and encryptions to be going on. The countermeasures are pretty straightforward. Stop using RC4 is an easy one that we can stand up here and say as the guys doing security research. It's kind of a hard one realistically, it's kind of hard to just stop using some algorithm for some organizations, right? But preferably the newer encrypted algorithms haven't been broken yet, so instead of going back to CBC. If you're stuck on RC4, there are some things that you can do to help make this even less realistic. Like padding that, so that first, remember when I said that you can reliably recover the first 220 of the first 256 bytes? That's because there's a 36 byte padding that just happens naturally. If you make that 36 byte padding bigger, then you're going to push the sensitive information out of the reliably recoverable bit of plain text, right? So it's kind of a hack, but it's doable. And then the pretty obvious one here, in my opinion, right, is, hey, billion requests, don't let that happen, right? let's not let a billion requests with the same session cookie go by in some short period of time. If you just are rate limiting this stuff, it becomes really, really hard to do. So moving on, more encryption.
So number four is the Lucky 13 attack. Now this is an attack on TLS, but DTLS as well this time, that allows a man-in-the-middle attacker to reliably get some form of plain text back so long as cipher blockchain encryption is being used. This was discovered by Professor Kenny Patterson and Nedhem Al-Fardin, whom both have past experiences in the analysis of secure network protocols, including SSH, IPsec, TLS, and DTLS, obviously. And they also played a part in the discovery of the past RC4 weakness that Matt just discussed. So the versions and questions here that are vulnerable are TLS 1.1 and 2.2, DTLS 1.0 and 1.2, and SSL 3.0 and TLS 1.0. So there is an Oracle padding attack involved in this, and what's significant is that TLS 1.0 does contain fixes to past padding Oracle attacks. They were able to just modify it and kind of get around it. There are also different variations of those versions of TLS and DTLS being used in the wild. Their attack can be tailored to work against those as well. So again, anything that's using cipher blockchain mode encryption is going to be vulnerable. They tested it against OpenSSL and GNUTLS. In OpenSSL, a full plaintext recovery was possible. In GNUTLS, they were able to recover up to 4 bits of the last byte in any block of plaintext.
It's a great year for OpenSSL, right?
Yeah, and then Heartbleed. So the way that works, obviously, is it uses something that's known as a padding oracle attack. And a padding oracle attack is a cryptographic side channel attack that is performed on the padding of a crypto message. So plaintext messages often need to be padded for encryption to occur. And this attack works against the portion of TLS that encrypts it and ensures the honesty or integrity of data. So in order to know how that works, you kind of need to know how a hash-based message authentication code, or an HMAC, works. And the quick, long, and short of it is that HMACs either use SHA-1, MD5, or SHA-256 as a hashing function. And those hash functions share similarity in that they have blocks of input in the size of 64 bytes. Now, if you go from a 64-byte input to a 65-bit input, an entire extra iteration has to be computed, which is going to cause a small but measurable delay. This attack has to be man in the middle, so as these packets are going over the network, they take it, change it, measure the error coming back, and if they can cause extra cycles to be made, you'll know that they're, or they'll know that they're on the right track. So they have to do this multiple times, just like in RC4. It's 2 times 10 to the 23rd in this case, so just about 8 million times. Still a bit theoretical, and the attacker must be on the same LAN. The reason he needs to be on the same LAN is because of network jitter. So doing this over the wire, doing this over Wi-Fi is not that feasible. There's just too much junk in the air. However, if you're doing it over the wire, in about 8 million samples, you can then use statistical analysis to discern what is native jitter to the network. Filter that out, look at the anomalies. Those are the packets that you've tampered with that have given back relevant information. So after all that's done, after you've captured 8 million packets and analyzed them, you only get 16 bytes of encrypted plaintext back. So that's an arbitrary large number of work for a very small amount of prize, really. So although this is a bit theoretical on TLS, it's a little bit more practical on DTLS, because when a record fails to decrypt due to a bad MAC or a padding error, TLS is going to kill a session. Datagram TLS doesn't do this at all. Now, should we be worried about something like this? Well, yes and no. No, in the sense that because when they found it, you know, they participated in responsible disclosure, they notified the vendors, got fixes out, and then released their research. However, it's a truism that attacks only get better with time, and we cannot anticipate what improvements to the attacks or entirely new attacks may have to be discovered. If this research is improved upon and brought out of the theoretical realm to be impractically exploited, we're in a whole world of trouble because of the amount of widespread use of TLS, as we all know.
Okay, cool. So we got our encryption out of our system for now, right? That's pretty deep stuff. So this one, how many of you guys saw this Black Hat talk? Handful of you. Okay, this is arguably the best Black Hat talk that I've ever seen. All right, this guy got like 2 or 3 standing ovations during his talk. This is a really, really creative talk, really cool hack. He brings a lot of stuff back that we thought we fixed on the web a long time ago, and he used some stuff that I didn't even know was out there, and you're going to see some of it. So hat tip to Paul Stone here, and again, these slides will be available. So this kind of goes for everything that we're talking about today. We're doing it like this much justice. If you're really interested in this, go watch the full Black Hat talks. This one very much in particular was a very, very good talk. Okay, so a little bit of history. Browser history sniffing, right? So this stuff has been around for quite a while, but one of the techniques to try to steal someone's history to someone's browser was something like a timing attack, right? So you can create some really quick JavaScript that does a timing attack on a website. Basically, it's going to take the whole crux of this is the page is going to take longer to load if you're logged in, because there's going to be a lot of content that needs to load, versus when you're not logged in, it's just the login form is going to be a much smaller web page, right? So something like Gmail, you have to load your whole email box. That's going to take a lot more time, measurably different time than the login box on Gmail, right? This, again, it's a technique that's been around for quite a while. Network jitter kind of stops this, makes it a little bit less practical. But even easier than that, back in 2008 is when this one came out. This was really easy. Okay, what happens when you click a link? It turns purple. Let's just check the CSS. Let's load up a bunch of links in an iframe and check the CSS if those links turn purple. Now all of a sudden you know if someone visited that web page or not, right? Back in 2010, the web browsers all fixed all this and said that, hey, there's no practical reason for any website that you're on to know what your CSS is doing. So you just can't even check CSS anymore for this particular thing. At the time, though, ad networks and adult sites were using this all over. I think it was some crazy percentage in the wild of ad networks and adult sites were measurably checking their visitors' history sniffing to more target the advertisers and stuff like that, right? So what's old is new again. Okay. Request animation frame. How many of you guys know what this is? Two of you. Cool. That's more than I even thought would raise their hands. I had no idea what this was until this research came out. So what request animation frame does is this function fires every time a new frame is painted in your browser, right? So just repainting is going on every time the browser changes something. At the beginning of that frame repaint, this function fires, okay? So that's kind of why this is important. So how this, and another piece that I didn't even know how this worked. So how this whole turning the link purple thing happens is it turns out to be pretty asynchronous. So there's a video during his talk that demonstrates this. We don't have time, so I'm just going to go through it real quick. So just the steps of when you go to a page, how it loads, right? The page is going to load. It's going to paint all the links, if there are any on the page. It's going to paint them blue, right? It's not going to wait to load the page to see if the person had been there before, right? So what happens is it fires off an asynchronous call to the history database locally on the browser. It's important that it's asynchronous, right? Because who wants to wait for a whole page to load to figure out if we should turn links purple or not? That's pretty low on the priority of a page loading, right? So that's going to fire off this asynchronous request. A bunch of frames are going to go by, and then when that callback comes from the history, it's going to say, "Okay, hey, repaint." And if there's, you know, if there was something visited, repaint it purple, right? But at the beginning of each of these frames, right, in this movie strip here, that request animation frame function fires, right? So that's also important to know. Okay, so sim it down now, right? So we have to, how are we going to slow this down so it's measurable? This is a timing attack, right? And as we know, timing attacks are not very reliable over the internet because of all sorts of jitter, right? But if we can slow it down, if we could slow this repainting down to something that's a measurable time difference, we could start to tell the difference, right? So what Paul does is he puts a whole bunch of links on a page, right? He gets all GeoCities on it and puts all sorts of shadows and all sorts of weird effects that we thought were cool back when we made our AngelFire websites, right? And it turns out that all of this, the more pixels that you're actually using, will affect the time that it takes to repaint. Kind of makes sense, right? It's small, but if you expedite this a little bit bigger, right? If you have 100 links in a frame or something like that, and you start throwing this shadow, the milliseconds get to be a little bit more measurable, right? So how it works, right? So we're going to load a frame with a ton. I kind of just went over this. We're going to load a frame with a ton of links to one URL. This is the one URL that we want to see if this user visited, right? We're going to put all the shadow and all the crappy web dev stuff on it, right? We're going to hijack request animation frame, right? We're going to hijack that function to actually fire our timing, right? We're going to time how long it takes this repaint to happen, right? If there's one slow frame, if one frame is slow, right? It's still milliseconds, right? But if it's slower than others, that means that's the first repaint, that's the initial repaint, and it just painted all the links, right? If there's a second slow frame, that means it needed to repaint those links and turn them purple, right? So here's his demo website. This is actually a video from his thing we don't have a video here, right? This is just a picture, right? So if you want to watch the video of this demo and go check out this website, I included the YouTube link here real quick. But that, all those hash signs on the left, that's the 100 or so links that he's populating to one URL. So he's going down this list on the right, right? And he's saying, okay, did they go to facebook.com, right? Okay, let's make every source value of all of those links to facebook.com and watch this repaint happen. So now you're gonna see in the timing attack, right, in these four columns. So that's the frame repaint times. So the first column you're gonna see, they're all in the 70 something millisecond range, right? Then the second frame is zero, or it's zero for almost all of them, right? Then the third frame is where you're gonna tell if something has been visited or not, because the longer ones in the 60 to 70 second millisecond range are the ones that have to turn purple, and the ones that are in the one or zero millisecond range didn't need another repaint, right? So his green check marks there are what this website is guessing were visited. So he got it all right here, right? So this tool proved that he got it all right by doing this timing attack. Really cool stuff. If you want to watch the video, I highly recommend it. Okay, so part two of this attack. So that's history sniffing. Really cool, right? So part two is where the pixel perfect timing comes in, right? So a whole bunch of other crap I didn't know existed, like request animation frame, is this FE morphology stuff. Enter SVG. This is all sorts of new functionality that's brought in with HTML5 and that we can do cool things to graphics. So two of the things that we want to do, this FE morphology tag, how many people have heard of this? One. Okay, even less than request animation frame. That's what I thought. No, put your hand up. FE morphology, what it does, if you can give it an image, and you know, this is all in HTML, it can change that image. But the two things that we're going to focus on are erosion and dilation of that image. We can either make it thicker or thinner, right? Because magic, who knows, right? But this is potentially pretty slow, right? If it has to go through every pixel in an image and figure out if it needs to make it thicker or thinner and the colors around it and all this kind of stuff, it's going to be pretty slow. So what the browsers did, I think Mozilla started and all the other browsers copied, was they wrote some optimized code that could just go down the left-hand side of the picture in certain situations. And that's way faster, right? Instead of going through every group of 4 pixels or something like that through the whole thing. This can be used when it's like a solid color, right? Instead of a noisy image. So if it's a noisy image, like the one on the left, like static or something like that, it's going to need to go through all of it to figure out what it's going to do, right? Which is going to be slower. If it's a solid image, it could just go down the left side, going to be much faster, right? Now there's another FE HTML function that I didn't know exist. FE composite, right? And that has an operator that you can multiply images. Of course, you can multiply images. Who knows, right? I don't know the legitimate purpose of this, okay? But you can multiply images together, and all we care about for the purpose of this research is if you take a solid image, like just a black image, and multiply it by a noisy image, so this is important, if it's black, if it's all dark, and you multiply it by a noisy image, you get an all dark solid image. If you take a white image and multiply it by noise, you get noise, okay? That's all you need to know about this multiplying thing for the purposes of this, right? I don't know why, but that's it. So real world usage, right? So we can create an iframe, right? You're the owner of a website, you create an iframe, people who visit your website can, you know, this iframe's gonna load. We're gonna take a snapshot of that iframe in time, because you don't want the things in the iframe to be changing while you're trying to read these pixels out of it and try to read what's in the iframe, right? So we're gonna take a snapshot in time. There's gonna be there's another SVG threshold filter that can change every pixel in that image to either black or white, right? Which is important based on this weird multiplication thing, right? So we're going to take the image, we're going to make it either black or white, and then we're going to do the multiplication by the known noisy image, and then we're going to profit, right? Because that has to be the last step in any step thing. So we're going to watch a video real quick of this demo. So what you're seeing here before I hit play is in the top left, he's kind of zoomed in on the iframe that he created. So he created an iframe of, I think this was, it was like a Google Plus comment box, okay? So for whatever reason, Google lets you iframe that kind of stuff in so you can include Google comment boxes on your website. And there's all sorts of cool information in there, like your name, your phone number, all sorts of stuff. So he's going to read, I think it's this one too, no? Okay, whatever. So he's going to read his name out of this iframe, pixel by pixel. So you already see he already changed it to black and white. I skipped that part. The right is going to be his output, what's coming out of it. And the bottom, it's going to be hard to see in this video, but that's the pixel that he's currently, the resulting of the multiplication that he's kind of looking at. So you're going to see black, and you're going to see kind of a noisy black. So that's why it's kind of hard to see. But that's the resulting pixel by pixel. And you're going to see him read out of this iframe, right when he clicks start here. He's kind of calibrating to the whole thing, and there he goes. Pixel by pixel. So you can kind of see the multiplication results changing here and there. I think the smaller one is the noisy one, and since it's kind of hard to see. If it slowed down, you would actually be able to see the difference. But there he goes. He reads his own name out of an iframe, right? Which you're obviously not supposed to be able to do, read the contents of an iframe. So we thought we fixed this a long time ago. Boom, this attack is back. But problems with this. It's a bit slow. You saw it took a little while to go all the way through this whole image. The result is an image. It's just resulting in another image, right? So you just get an image, so a human actually has to look at this image that comes back, right? So what if we wanted it to be faster and we wanted the result to be text, right? We don't want a human to have to look at it. We just want the result to be text so that it can be fed into a program and all this kind of stuff. Well, one thing you need to know if you want to do text is you need to know the font that you're going through pixel by pixel, because every font is going to be different, right? Well, it turns out that source code has a standard font, and that you can iframe, you can put a source in an iframe of view-source and then the website. So you could just iframe the source code of some website, all standard font, right? all sorts of juicy information there, right? If you can iframe someone in into some web page and view the source code, there could be their CSRF tokens, all sorts of private information, IP addresses, yada, yada, right? Okay, so how this whole font breakdown works really quick. I don't want to spend too much more time on this one. But okay, so what you're looking at here is this is all the hex character set, right? And you're looking at a heat map. So we're going to look at this top one, right? This is if you take all the hex characters and lay them on top of each other, that's a heat map of pixels used in that font, okay? The red ones are not necessarily the most used. The red ones are exactly half are used, okay? So what that lets you do is pick a pixel and then divide it in half. Okay, exactly half did use this pixel, exactly half did not use that pixel, and so on and so forth, and you can create a binary tree here so that you can narrow down the number of pixels that you need to read to reliably read some text, right? So in hex, do I have the notes here? Yeah, so in hex, you just need to read 4 pixels. If you read 4 pixels, you know the character, right? In alphanumeric, you need 5, and full special character set, you need 6, right? So one more video here, and then we'll move on. Same thing, that's the iframe, that's the resulting pixel, he's calibrating to the font, and now this is the resulting text that's being spit out of this Google comment box. So there's his Google ID, text by text, see how it's way faster, and the result is not an image, the result is text. So you can actually feed this into something programmatically and use it to hack stuff. Why not have 2 telephone numbers in your phone, in your Google comment box, right? It's kind of crazy. Okay, cool. So beat that one to death, but I think that one's really cool. So we're going to move on to some more encryption stuff.
So now we're moving on to breach, which is our number 2 attack. And this is an absolutely awesome attack that just completely demolished SSL. And it's so much faster than the past RC4 and Lucky 13 attacks that we were talking about. So this was discovered by Angelo Prado, Neal Harris, and Yoel Gluck at Black Hat USA last year. And they also released an expansion onto this attack that was at Black Hat this year. So they're doing awesome things with this one, just completely just demolishing SSL.
So a little bit of history real quick. So Crime, you saw on the list, it won last year, two years ago, I forget. Crime won the top 10 a few years back, right? So the history of what Crime was doing is it's decrypting HTTPS traffic that is using request compression, right? So if you're using any sort of request compression, things like Speedy, use it by default. Like if you're using a Speedy protocol, use it by default. TLS compression, I'm sorry, not request compression, TLS compression. And at the time, I think the survey said 42% of sites in service were using TLS compression. It makes sense. It's, hey, make it faster, period, right? That's like a no-brainer for anybody. So that's really the important part to know about Crime. It just kind of decrypts any TLS traffic that's being compressed, right? So how this compression works, so breach, instead of using TLS compression on the request, it's worried about the compression on the response. So things like gzip compression, which you guys are probably pretty familiar with, it's really, really popular. that's what breach is attacking. So a little bit of how this compression works, right? So the one that we're going to focus on is this top one right here. So you can kind of see what's going on. Anytime a string is found in the response, the first time that string is found, it's left alone. But any subsequent time that exact string is found again, a pointer is assigned to it to point to that string earlier in the text, right? So in this case, Googling the Googles, the OOGL is the same string, and so the compression result is gonna say, hey, go back 13 characters, go forward 4 characters. It's gonna be way smaller, it's gonna compress a pretty significant amount. So in real world, right? So this is in HTTP responses, right? Say we had some ability to inject some text into the HTTP response, and we're going to start brute forcing some super secret thing, right? How this attack is going to work is you're going to measure the size of the resulting response, right? So if you're brute forcing this super secret and you have everything but the last letter, that last letter isn't going to compress correctly, right? So say we just had this X, right? You're going to get the whole string is going to compress except for the one you don't have right. So the resulting response is going to be 38 bytes big. As soon as you do get that right, it's going to successfully compress that one more letter in, and you're going to get a response that's measurably smaller. So that's kind of how this attack works. In order to have this work, you're going to need, it's kind of similar to like reflective cross-site scripting when you need an in. You need something that you control in the source code, right? These researchers called it a canary. I kind of like that analogy, right? This is your canary that you're going to use to brute force into this.
So a couple things that you need for this to work. Obviously, you need compression. It's all over the web, all browsers support it, no big deal there. Also, it's better if you have fairly stable pages, because we're looking for reflection, we're looking for a certain value there, be it a CSERF token, an OAuth token, whatever it is in the response that we want to target ourselves. The more dynamic the page is, they can still do it, it just takes a little bit longer. If the page is completely static, about 30 seconds, they can get whatever secret. We need SSL, something that we're actually looking for, and then we also need some type of successful bootstrap sequence. So we need to kind of have three characters that we already know are going to be correct before we can continue on. However, the entropy of those three characters can be really low. Like that canary, that CSERF token, it's what? Lowercase, uppercase, and numbers. For only three characters long, that entropy isn't exactly too high.
And this is what's required for breach, to actually strip this in 30 seconds, right? This isn't necessarily required for the strip.
Way. Yeah. Now, so you know, your basic man-in-the-middle scenario, the attacker needs to be on a LAN because he needs to get the SSL traffic. And moving on, because we're getting kind of low on time, this is just their basic command and control server, which is just basically performing all the logic and doing the decryption.
This doesn't really have to do with the actual hack. This is like their exploit.
These are like their tools that they were using for it. They didn't open source it. They just kind of said, hey, you can throw your site in here and we can see if we can breach it. Not really too important. So this is part of a snippet from their live demo at Black Hat, where they pulled that CSERF token out from Outlook Web Access.
They had some really cool Mission Impossible music playing during this, so if you're a fan, I would watch their Black Hat talk.
So here you can see a couple of the pass requests that were going by in Chrome, and if you look at the bottom, they were able to get the entire thing in 43 seconds in about 1,120 requests. That's a whole lot better than 8 million for Lucky 13 or a billion for RC4.
This is extremely realistic, right? Okay, so mitigation, what do you do to fix against this stuff, right? Well, easy one is disable your compression, but good luck winning that battle. Hey, do you want to make your website slower to make it more secure? Yeah, you're going to get laughed out of the room, right? So some other things that you can do, and we actually at White Hat upped our bar for what was good enough for a CSRF protection because of this attack. We used to allow CSRF tokens to stay the same for an entire session, because that session should be encrypted the entire time. But now that if you're using compression, that's not the case anymore. We upped our bar to you have to have your CSRF tokens be dynamic per form in order for it to be good enough if you're using compression, right? So the dynamic secrets. If you want to do, there's some hacky other things to do this. If you want to chunk your responses, that'll throw them off. You can ZOR your whole thing. It's all pretty dirty. The real one is throttling and monitoring, right? Even though it's only 1,100 requests versus a billion, that's still something that's measurable, right? Hey, don't let 1,100 requests go to the same IP with the same cookie and CSRF token very, very quickly, right? That should spike some sort of anomalous behavior.
Cool. So number one, mutation XSS. Now, has anyone heard of mutation XSS or MXSS yet?
Cool.
A couple people. Cool. So that's still not enough. We all know about reflective, persistent, and DOM XSF. We've heard about that for years. So now there's a fourth XSS that we need to worry about, and this was discovered by Mario, he's the god of XSS. This guy loves everything in between tags and just absolutely demolishes it with new research over and over again. So mutation XSS is a way that we are going to trick the browser to formulate our injection for us. So say we give it A, the browser's going to give us B. A gets by the filters, A gets by the IDSs. When the response comes back, thank you, browser, you gave us the XSS. So just to give a quick history, let's just go through like what the problems typically are with XSS and how they're really not that hard to fix if you think about it. Reflective XSS typically comes in through the query string, URL parameters, big deal. We validate input, we encode output, problem solved. Persistent XSS usually comes in through post requests, file uploads, saved on the server somewhere. We can still fix that with output encoding, input validation, and then heck, you can even diff the responses that you're expecting to see, like this is a good response, this is a bad response. The bad response is something different, you should probably take a look at it. DOM XSS is solved by simply being a smarter coder. Is that too much to ask, really? You learn about source and syncs, as you learn about the proper functions that you should use, how to not trust user input. So you would think that with proper whitelists, proper usage of CSP, XSS whitelists, the proper protection headers, we should be able to mitigate XSS fully. MXSS just shows us that there's another little kink in JavaScript that's always doing magical stuff to make things different for us. So a little bit of history. Back in IE4, Internet Explorer gave us access to editing the DOM with inner HTML. It was a lot easier and a lot more convenient than the traditional way of doing it. Like the DOM way would be, you know, you create an ID, create a div, create a tag for it, add it to it, append the childs. It's a little bit of a headache. The inner HTML way, create the tag that you want, make it object-oriented, you add the object to the inner HTML, and then there you go. Real easy. It's easy, it's fast, it just works, everyone does it. Now, if you go through code searches for how many people are actually using inner HTML in the wild, no surprise there, it's a butt ton. So 184 in code.google, almost 1.2 million in GitHub. The Alexa top 1,000, he found 745 websites using it. This is not surprising. Everyone uses inner HTML. So what you want to, what we'd like to assume is that inner HTML would be idempotent. So whatever we give it should be what comes out. If we give it A, we should expect to have A coming out as well. There's a little tool on the HTML5Sec cheat sheet, just slash inner HTML, where you can test this depending on which browser.
This is a great website overall, even not just this attack. If you guys are interested in this stuff, HTML5Sec.org has one of the best HTML5 cheat sheets, the best HTML5 cheat sheet out there. It's really, really good stuff.
Yeah, so I've recreated the demo real quick from IE6, which is screenshots. So what you see going on here is we have four different frames. The top one is going to be the input that we give it. The second one is going to be that being rendered. The third one is going to be after HTML, or after inner HTML has tainted it, and then the fourth one is going to be what that renders. Does that bottom left part cut off a little bit? It sure does. That's perfect.
It's okay.
Let's see how bad. Oh god, that's actually pretty rough.
It's okay.
Okay, so I'm just going to explain what's going on. Man, that is awful. Okay, so essentially what's going on here is that if you just make a tag, like a strikeout tag, with some content in the middle, foobar, no big deal. You see that it's stricked out. But look at the third one. You can see that S is capitalized, right? So what inner HTML has done is it actually took our S tag and it capitalized it. No reason for that to happen, but that's all right. It was the standard in HTML4 that HTML tags are capitalized. Okay, so the browser's just trying to help us. Now here, if you don't show a closing S tag, just look at that third one again. The browser, or inner HTML, supplied it again. So we didn't put a closing tag in there, but it thinks, hey, maybe you're a bad developer, you forgot to close your tag.
Can you guys in the back see the top one? You can't really see it. Oh. We left off the closing S tag, okay? Yeah. It kind of stinks that you can't see it. So we left off that closing S tag, and the browser added the closing S tag for us and still struck the text out. It said, hey, you were silly, you left this out. Of course, you meant this. So it does it for us, right?
So here what you have is a div tag with an empty string class, and the div tag is not closed off. So if you look there in that third one, if you can see it, you're going to have just an opening div tag with no class equals empty string. Because once inner HTML has been applied to it, it sees that class doesn't have a value. It's going to strip it, save some computation cycles, and then just kind of try to make things faster.
And thanks for closing our tag again.
Yeah, and close the div tag again as well. So here we have just class equals tests, quote delimited. If you can make it out on the third screen down there, now class is not quote delimited. Because it knows that class equals test. Again, it stripped out two characters to try to optimize things to make it a little bit faster. So here, we have a space in the class equals test. And now if you look in the third one, we have space equals quote delimited test with the space in the middle there. So now quotes have been supplied again. Again, without the space, we have no quotes. With it, we now have quotes down there.
Third box there.
So okay, inner HTML is being a little funky based on what input's being given. If you use a single tick, the same thing happens. If you put that single tick at the beginning, so look at the top one, we have double quote delimited single tick test. But in the bottom, those double quotes aren't there anymore. And at the very bottommost tag, foobar doesn't exist anymore. Because now the HTML is broken. We've essentially broken the DOM structure. When you add in a second double tick, that bottom foobar shows back up. So now the tag is actually being rendered. But what it thinks is happening here is that class is an empty string, and then we have an empty attribute named test. So if you look at that top one, we didn't actually try to break out of class by like breaking out of it. Inner HTML did it for us. So you would think we can put in a proper injection with that, right? Sure enough, you can. So here we just have image source equals X, class equals quote delimited, or double quote delimited, backtick backtick on error equals alert one. And then what the inner HTML has done for us after it's transformed it is class equals backtick backtick, which IE6 will process as a delimiter. So there's an empty class, and now on error equals alert one, the source is going to be the site that I was on, which is html5sec.org/innerHTML, because source equals X up there. And you've given a completely non-valid XSS vector. The browser has transformed it, and it's fired. So that's the cool thing about mutation XSS. We're taking the way that innerHTML is going to taint the data. We've given it A, B comes out. A isn't really an injection, B is. So now we have a fourth type of XSS to worry about and really to try to harden our systems against. This is still pretty new. Gareth Hayes also has done a lot of work about this, and his site is like thespanner.co.uk. He has an awesome new write-up about it that I really recommend that everyone check it out and read. So just because we're paying homage to Mario and the people that he does research with, he credits these people for helping him find mutation XSS. So it's only proper for us to do the same thing. So thanks to Gareth Hayes, Yoshi Kasagawa, there's a Russian hacker who goes by the handle Lever1, Eduardo Vella, Dave Ross, and Stefano Di Paolo. So thank you guys.
Cool. So what we've learned, right? So what did we learn this year? So what's old is new again, right? We thought we fixed browser history sniffing. We thought we fixed this iframe stuff. We thought we fixed the encryption weaknesses from last year, and a lot of it came back, right? Encryption, once again, even though it didn't take top slot, it took three of the top five. It says that the community really respects the amount of research that goes into encryption research. It's way above my head and pay grade. So we just want to thank those guys. They're academic and it's phenomenal, even though it's all theoretical right now. It's really, really deep level stuff, and the community still appreciates it. And creativity, that's always something, you know, the GIFR attack back in the day, the pixel perfect timing this year, these are things that are really out of the box thinking. This isn't the traditional do this, hack this, this comes out, whatever, right? This is really creative stuff. You know, Mario using some weird thing that the browser does to try to help you to create a whole new XSS attack vectors is really crazy. So this is just kind of our lessons learned really quick, right? So I just wanted to take a minute to thank our panel of judges. This is not a small amount of research to wrap your brain around and actually meaningfully vote and order this stuff. So this is a decent amount of time that we're asking them for. I want to ask anyone who's ever voted in one of these top 10 lists, keep doing it. It's awesome. If you've ever submitted a technique, we're getting ready. We're gearing up for the next year's list already. Please, you know, submit us techniques. And when we put watch out for the links, you can watch our Twitter handles or anything like that to actually vote on the top 15. Without the community voting on this stuff, this list wouldn't exist.
Yeah,
so
it's completely community driven.
So yeah, and this is just our way of paying homage to all the researchers, you know, all you guys out here. So thanks, everyone. Thank you.